speak of be what?
I'm never alone.
That is scary, but I understand it. That was funny when you came to me. Hello. How are you?
Check one. Check one, two.
Okay, as long as you get somebody separate.
Yes.
Give Dave a little bit of water back here. Anybody want to give him a water? Somebody get him a water. All right, Psalms 121. I will lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of the heavens and the earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. Yes. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from harm, all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. Lord, we look to you tonight and worship you in spirit and truth, because you are the author of truth and the devil is the author of lies.
Yes.
And God, we know that you hold all things together. You created the heavens and the earth, and we look to you, God, to orchestrate our lives. We look to you and we walk by faith, knowing that we can trust you when we don't feel you. We can trust you when our emotions don't line up. God, we can trust the word, because the word is our bedrock for our soul. God, we can look to you when we're hopeless, because you're the anchor of our life. God, we can look to you, to which our help comes from. When we're hopeless, you give us hope. Lord, thank you for the trials in our lives, because it produces character in our lives. Help us to persevere through the tough times and not shrink back and go backwards and do the same things we've always done. Lord, we look to you. You are love. You are God.
Yes.
And you are love. Yes. God, show us what that looks like in our lives personally. God, show us what true unconditional love looks like. In Jesus' name, let's rock out. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And when things don't go my way, Lord, I'll trust you. Even when things don't go my way, well, you're the God of reconciliation, Lord, I'm asking you for some sanctification. Play it, Dan.
Sometimes the little people have to speak. So anybody that has children, 12 and under, if you want to bring them to Sunday school class, well, I guess that would be Friday school class, huh? Sorry, old habits. Past the bar, you can go now. Just bring them down, sign them in. They've got a lesson and some activities to do. So just past the bar, first left, and then a left. So that's any kids from 12 and under right now. And we're planning on doing this every week. We're getting back in the swing. We had a couple of our people that were key to this, both had surgeries and were out for a while, so we were kind of stuck. But now it's back in swing, so each week it'll be there. It'll be available for everybody. Yeah. And if anybody would like to help out and get in on the rotation so we don't burn anybody out, that would be awesome. We need a couple of teachers to rotate in and assistants. Assistants, your job is just to make sure the little ones don't escape, don't bleed out, and that's it. I mean, we're simple in that. And of course, we do have to chore you, but, you know, no big deal there. So So guys, you know that our goal is not just to be here and to spend our time here. Now, we do come in on Tuesdays. We have 6 o'clock prayer. It's open to everybody. We have like 24 people showing up. It's awesome. You might want to pray quiet. You might want to pray out loud. You might want to just absorb what's going on, or you might want to ask people to pray for you. Doesn't matter. Just come. It's becoming an incredible, powerful movement, drawing people close, and we're just seeing the Lord just move in so many lives. So that's Tuesday at 6. And then at 7 o'clock, we have a Bible study. The study we're working on is how to not be offended. Now, we're all going to get offended, but it's what we do with it afterwards. And geez, if we could just learn to release this stuff and get rid of it. So this study is phenomenal. It's 7 to 8:30. And then, of course, over here in this room, it's anonymous, but it's still over there. It's NA at 7:45. So you guys have your options on Tuesdays. We try to keep everything close together so that we're not inside the building all the time. But now on Thursdays, anyone that's a teenager, we've got youth group going. So from 5 o'clock till 8:30, I think, 8, something like that. Yeah, I'm getting the thumbs up. So 5 to 8 anyways. Bring any of your teenagers here. Drop them off. I mean, how much better can get? Someone's going to take care of your kids and do stuff with them. That's it for staying in. Our goal is always to go out. You can't just be the church inside the walls. We want to be the church outside there. We want to be accessible to people. We want to be available to pray with them, to hold their hands, to listen to them, to help them. So we get that opportunity on Sunday. Jerry Remses, she's a longtime supporter here and here very often. She's always doing stuff with the vets. She has her American Legion Legacy Run. So this is a fundraiser for kids whose parents were killed in action. And we've done this year after year. It's down in up in Dedham, whichever way. No, from here, it's down in Dedham. And we go there, and not only do they have Tom do a general blessing, but they are thrilled to have us go from person to person to see what we can do for pray for them, to bless them, just to be there for them. And this group is waiting for us every year. Where's my new sticker? Where's my new sticker? So we need to get out in the masses on Sunday. We'll be meeting there at 9. So from 9 to 10, buy a motorcycle. But if you have a car, drive your car, whatever you got to do to get there. If you have a helicopter, that's wicked cool. So you can arrive by helicopter, but you should see me because we may need to hook up with you at some point in time. So, but that event is from 9 to 10:30. We get to do blessings, and then the run goes out from there. Anyone that wants to ride in with us will be leaving from our house, 195 Torrey Street, Brockton. We'll be leaving at 8:15. So if you want to join us in the ride, we'll go to there. Otherwise, meet us there. And if you've never done blessings before, don't worry. You can just stand with someone that's doing it. We just need to have people there to help these guys. And we don't mind taking someone new along with us and just having you walk alongside us. That's awesome. Okay. There are 2 retreats coming up for men and women separately. And I'm a little jealous because the men's one gets to go and shoot guns. I'm not sure who sets these things up. Someday we're going to start our own one for women because this whole not shooting guns thing is ridiculous. Yeah. So not these guns. Real guns. Anyways, they're on the bulletin board. They're also on Facebook. If anybody needs any information on it, those are the 2 places we have them. And lastly, I think I got it. I think I can turn it over. Okay. He's usually behind the camera, but I guess he's getting in front of the camera. Come on up, Mark. We still have Broken Chains Biker Church bracelets, keychains, and necklaces available at the bar, the non-alcoholic bar.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Mark. I just wanted to, I've been asked to relay a small, short story. A friend of mine has been very ill. Over a year ago, he was diagnosed with cancer. He has stage 4 cancer with liver, the stomach, and he hasn't been doing very well. And I was very concerned about his spiritual condition because, as you all know, when we pass on, we're going somewhere. And I was really concerned about if he really knows the gospel message. And so I asked Pastor Tom if he would accompany me to have a pastoral visit and try to get that message across. And it seemed the visit went very well, and he knows, you know, who Jesus is, and I'm very happy about that. What else I wanted to say? The night before we went to visit him, he had a very terrible night. And after the day that we visited him, he slept very well. We prayed with him before he left. He was very impressed by Pastor Tom. And this really, what I'm about to say really means something. He said when he gets better, hopefully he'll get better. I don't know what's going to happen. He could get better. But he said, I would like to go to Broken Chains Biker Church. And coming from my friend, that is a miracle, because I've asked him to do a lot of things. I think I've asked him to come here. Every time I've asked him to do something, he always declines. And this, I didn't ask him, oh, do you want to go to church? He said to me, I want to go there. So that is a wonderful thing to hear from my friend. And, you know, and if I don't know what's going to happen with him. If he passes on, I will see him in heaven, and that makes me very happy. Hallelujah. Thank you.
You know what? Sing it. It's just so- misdirecting my very life today. Give me shelter, or I'm gonna fade away. Oh, that children, you should still pray away. You should still pray away. Oh, God's children, you should still pray away. You should still pray away. Oh, God's children, you should still pray away. You should still pray away. Rose on the third day, he rolled a stone away. He rolled a stone away. Rose on the third day. God rolled the stone away. God rolled the stone away. Rose on the third day. He rolled a stone away. Stone away. Stone away. Rose on the third day. He rolled a stone away. 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 Stone away. Stone away. He rolled a stone away. Hallelujah. This is a song that I wrote a long time ago about the blood of Jesus Christ. and wave them goodbye. With you I will sing, with a song I will end. Together forever we'll raise angels to sing. Hallelujah, we have overcome. Hallelujah, by the blood of the Lamb. It is love, it is love. By the blood of the Lamb, it is done. By the blood, the victory is already won. By the blood of the Lamb, it is done.
Whatever you need, God's got it. Amen. Come on. And whatever you need, God's already given it to us in Jesus' name. Amen. Because he said, all authority in heaven and earth have been given unto me. And now I send you. Any yous in the crowd?
Yeah,
that'd be you.
Oh, yeah.
That's right. You're appointed and anointed for a time such as this. Hey, you guys know that we've been preaching through this book, Jesus is an Airborne Ranger. It really touched me because of my personal military history, but also because it really paints Jesus in a very masculine sense.
Amen.
And one of the deals here at Broken Chains Biker Church is we love women, man. We love women. Don't ever get me wrong. I'm amazed at the anointing of my wife. I love her every day. I love you, ladies.
Oh, yeah.
But this church is here to let men know how to be men in Jesus Christ. And when the men will rise up and know who they are, that they don't follow some wimpy Jesus, then women are going to say, I want to be where the action is right there. Because when men rise up as spiritual heads of the household, when men rise up as the warriors they're called to be, when men rise up and walk in the power of the Holy Spirit and the anointing that God's given them, stuff happens. And then they encourage their women to do the same thing. And when men and women filled with the Holy Spirit go into this lost and dying world, stuff happens. Oh, come on, somebody. Now, look, there's three things that I had to write my notes to myself. Next week, we have a special guest speaker flying in all the way from Arizona. Who would that be, you ask? Well, I'm glad you asked. That would be Joe Jackson, not the 80s music guy, as I was asked earlier, but he was actually a football player. Of course, you don't know him because what nation is this? Patriots Nation. Yeah, and he was with some Viking dudes in some New York place that I'm not sure who they are. But he's awesome, and he's coming to share the story of how God uses him now. So please be here next Friday to hear from Joe Jackson and, you know, just what's on his heart. Also, you may know little Jonathan back there has a cake in front of him. So this is probably a great time to sing, "Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jonathan. Happy birthday to you." And there was a life celebration for a man who changed people's lives in an anonymous program. He was a sponsor of one of the men who comes to this church. His name was Jimbo. And he passed away this week, and we've mourned at the loss of the people who have counted on him. And I pray that people have been faithful witnesses around him. And he died knowing who he was in Jesus Christ. And we know what a blessing he's been in this life to people like Rick, and we mourn with Rick because they were very close. And so, you know, give Rick some condolences and some props, all right? All right. Stop that. Every time I move, it does that. So tonight's message is from chapter 2 of Jesus Was an Airborne Ranger by John McDougall. He's an Army Ranger chaplain and an Army Ranger. And we're welcoming back one of our brothers in the Lord who's been a ward of the state for a while. And he's come back and said, "I need to draw nearer to Jesus, so you better start reading." Amen. The Lord's done a mighty work with him, and we're just excited to have him. So look, this chapter, the title was The Great Raid on Mission with Jesus. And the fifth stanza of the Ranger Creed says, "I will never leave a fallen comrade to fall into the hands of the enemy." Come on, somebody. That's right. So that's part of the Ranger Creed. Now, in Luke 19, it says, "The Son of Man came to seek and save those who were lost." Because the Son of Man jumped in. Amen? Now, at the beginning of the story, we hear, now I'm going to see if I do well with this, the Cabanatu story. So Cabanatu was a city in the Philippines during World War II. The Japanese overran it, and they took prisoners. And they took all these prisoners on a well-known death march. And the Japanese were particularly ruthless to prisoners of war. I'm sure the man who surrendered probably regretted it afterwards, thinking, well, we better surrender, we're better off. They were not. And so for a grueling march, many were just murdered randomly, beat up randomly. The Japanese had them captured for quite a while. The U.S. forces were trying to figure out what to do with all of this. In the meantime, the Japanese were torturing, killing, murdering. But then the American forces were advancing. It was obvious that the Americans were going to take this place back. And as that happens, the cowardly people do what? They start to exterminate their enemies. And so some of these men were rounded up into some of the bunkers and lit on fire. and burned to death. These prisoners were treated horribly by their captors. We've been talking a lot about Satan, who's our abuser, who's actually the one who's captured us, who is the prince of this air, and what Satan does to us, how Satan grabs us and intoxicates us or grabs us and says, this looks great, follow me. Don't listen to God. And then we see what comes out of it. There's complete wreckage. But I can say that we've got a video clip of what the Americans did. Can you dim those lights down? What the Americans did during that time is the Americans said, well, we got to come up with a plan here. Let's just take a look at a few clips. This was called The Great Raid, and there was a movie done in 2005. And let's see if they captured some of the feeling of what went on as these Americans went to free these captives in the video that's coming with sound. Any time now.
This proven battalion in this whole army. This is your one chance to do something about it. And I mean one chance. Is that clear?
Yes, sir!
Their mission was almost certain to fail.
There's too many unknowns. They cannot guarantee the safety of those prisoners.
250 Japanese in that camp. Another 1,000 at the river. 10,000 more nearby. Only 120 of us. I figure we're gonna need a little miracle.
Do you have a reason to survive this war?
I'd like to be here for your surrender.
Miramax Films presents the true story of the greatest rescue mission ever attempted. And a moment in time when men of honor became soldiers of destiny.
This is the kind of glory you carry inside you for the rest of your life.
Nothing in our lives will ever be as important as this.
There's a price for freedom, a price some are willing to pay.
When men of valor become soldiers of destiny. Any soldiers of destiny in the house?
Oh, yeah.
Come on, somebody. So if the prisoners of the POW camp outside this city of this Philippine city, were to avoid being executed during the Japanese retreat from the Philippines, it was going to take a daring raid behind enemy lines. The camp needed to be liberated, and the men evacuated to safety. So Lieutenant Colonel Henry Mucci and his 6th Ranger Battalion was the natural choice for the job. This is the first job that Rangers really had in the Japanese front, in the Philippines. This was the first job, and this was an unproven battalion at the time. They had a lot of elite training, but they had been unproven. And they were the natural choice. They were an elite group of fighters who used speed and stealth so well, it was like it was in their DNA. So on January 28th, 1945, Mucci and these 121 Rangers crossed enemy lines and headed towards that city. For 2 days, the Rangers avoided detection and remained hidden until conditions were set for the raid. Aided by an aerial diversion, Mucci and his men advanced towards the camp and attacked. In less than 20 minutes, Rangers breached the gate, overwhelmed 800 Japanese guards, defeated the garrison, and readied former POWs to move. Ooh. Are you goosebumpy, somebody? It was such an astounding feat. The Great Raid was made into a movie in 2005. And our author, Chaplain McDougall, references this a lot throughout his whole book. He talks about this Great Raid. In fact, he frames where we are now because he wants to show us that we're actually in the middle of just such a raid right now. each and every one of us. In Ranger doctrine, a raid is defined as a deliberate, small-scale, covert attack, typically behind enemy lines, where success depends on speed, surprise, and violence of action. Raids are used to obtain information, to confuse the enemy, or destroy installations or equipment. Sometimes a raid is used to rescue prisoners of war, civilian hostages, as they were in this situation. Could it really be that your life today, no matter how ordinary it seems to you, is at the center of a global rescue mission? Could you actually be trapped deep behind enemy lines in a hopeless situation? Or, having been liberated, could God be calling you to join his great raid to rescue others at home, on motorcycles, in your neighborhood, and the world? Our enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion. He makes a lot of noise. Yeah. But we're stealth. On top of basic training in infantry school and jump school, Rangers endure 62 days of Ranger school. And only the most elite, only the very best, which is a tiny minority, make it through. And during Ranger school, they study and execute dismounted infantry raids. That means they're walking. They're not jumping. They're walking under the eye of instructors. In fact, Rangers very proudly will tell you they can run farther, faster, and longer than any other group in the military. They get so that they can conduct these attacks in their sleep. After rehearsed raids on small objectives in nine-man squad, they progress to 40-man platoons, training to execute covert operations in enemy territory using both climbing techniques in mountains, in the terrains of deserts, water movements, marsh movements. If you can think of an extreme climate that's impossible to get through, that's where they train. No matter what the conditions, the purpose of the raid is the same: to move undetected to a position of advantage from which to successfully accomplish a mission. As Rangers prepare to go on target, their confidence is bordering on arrogance. They are experts in their field, executing rapid assaults with lethal effects better than anyone in the world, and they know it. As soon as they get the mission, these elite warriors file into the ready room to grab their tools of war with calm efficiency that only comes with repetition. They don helmets and body armor and load into vehicles. Ahead comes only danger, but they are prepared. And the question, brothers and sisters, are you? Because we are called to a mission. We're called to be armed. We're called to be prepared. We're called to be covert and overt. We're called to be prepared for this mission, to be able to stand on the word of God, to live it out as an example, but also to walk in power to save those who've been captured or lulled by our enemy. Amen?
Amen.
That's our job. And there has been a mission underway, and it's a spiritual one, and we're deeper than we think. The goal of this great raid is to rescue us from the darkness and offer us true freedom. Since the beginning, God has been at work to bring back his captive sons and daughters from behind enemy lines. It's by joining forces with our mission commander, Jesus, that we have our greatest fulfillment and purpose in life. I want to tell you that this week, a number of our members went through a course called Soul Care. It's a very intensive course where we deal with the stuff of our life. One of the things that the Bible tells us is the Holy Spirit flows from the heart of God like a river. And that river goes from his heart to our heart when we have Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. He wants to just load here, man, I'm going to give you the full load. But what happens is, if you, I grew up in the woods, and as a kid, we always, my whole deal with my friends, what we did for fun, we didn't have video games, we diverted streams. That's, if I get these rocks and logs, I can make this stream go this way. This is going to be awesome. We dig ditches and we move the streams and flood the neighbor's yard. And then we'd get in trouble. But you know what? In our lives, we've diverted the flow of the stream of the Holy Spirit from God's heart to ours with offense, with a victim mentality, with feeling like everybody's out to get me, with the wounds. Maybe we're attacked. Maybe we're hurt some way. Maybe we actually have been horribly mistreated, but we've put resentments and we've put blocks. And so there's just a trickle of Holy Spirit power coming to us, and we're thirsty, and we hunger and thirst for the righteousness of God, but the stream's blocked by our junk. So in soul care, we deal with that. Many people who are in an anonymous program know that we're supposed to take a fearless moral inventory of all the things that we've done, right? And that fearless moral inventory goes to a certain place. But what about the unconfessed? What about, see, the stuff that makes us stumble and crawl and stay broken is what's unconfessed and undealt with. And often we're saying, God, fix it. Please, God, fix this thing in me. Fix this thing in me. And he says, I gave you all this stuff. I'm giving you the whole flow. You got to uncork the stream, dude. I gave you all this stuff. Those people that went through soul care were delivered from a number of issues. For a number of demonic issues, some demonic oppression. Demons can oppress Christians. A lot of this stuff, some people have just endured horrible, horrible things that had to be handled and dealt with. And the Holy Spirit will heal those things. Or sometimes we just hang on to them like festering boils. We don't deal with our stuff, and we begin to wind up and wind up and wind up. Some of us were talking today about we've been irritated, and the more we're irritated, one guy, Eric, said, sometimes I feel like that thing, that operation game, my nose is lighting up. Everything. You said something, ooh, I'm mad. But we get to the root of what that is, and the Holy Spirit pulls that out. He says, I'll heal this. I'll heal this. Well, look, all this started on the day that Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, giving birth to humanity's need to be rescued. When our ancestors ate the forbidden fruit, two facts emerge. All humanity is now enslaved by the enemy. That's how we're born. We're born slaves to sin. We're enslaved to the enemy. And two, any hope of rescue would require a raid behind enemy lines. Now look, tough guys in particular don't like the idea that somebody needs to save them. I do. Do have you asked for directions, men? I'm good. Know exactly where I'm going.
I got a GPS.
I don't need to ask directions. And the GPS lady lies. I've been here before. But tough guys don't like the idea that we need to be saved. You may not see that there are guards on you or feel the chains, but disbelief is the enemy's greatest feat. That and his math problem of division. Right. Yeah, Dave came up with that.
Sure?
Satan continually lies, telling people that they're free when they're actually in his snare. So, anybody at 10 years old start smoking cigarettes because it seemed to be cool? Yeah, man, that's cool. And everybody wants to stop me from smoking cigarettes, and I want to smoke cigarettes. I want to be like the cool kids. And now here you are, 45, with a $20 day habit, and you can't put them down, and they keep raising the prices and taxing them, and you're just paying the tax man. You complained about taxes, but you're stuck on the cigarettes. And you didn't think you were getting enslaved, but you did. Or maybe, like me, you started to drink when you were 11. Or maybe you started to use drugs because that seems cool. They all seem fun until you're addicted and you lose everything, including your very dignity. And maybe you've decided, you know, I should be able to have sex outside of marriage. This is great fun. I love sex. Sex is awesome. By the way, God created sex. It's good stuff between a husband and a wife. But you know what? Some of us, me included, I did a lot of bad stuff. Well, here's the deal, though. Until the test turns positive, and we're now responsible for another life without the benefit of a committed, married mother and father. Because maybe you didn't really want to marry this person. You're just having a good time. And now you've got a conundrum. What am I going to do? I don't really like this person, but I want to love my child. And what do I do? And maybe we've been staying with a boyfriend or girlfriend that's clearly taking us down. But we're desperate and we're too afraid to take God's promises seriously. So we hang on to what's even lethal and toxic for fear that God wouldn't give us something better. There's a cartoon of a young girl, and she's holding her little plastic pearl necklace, and Jesus comes to her, and he says, hey, why don't you give me that pearl necklace? She's like, oh, no, I value this pearl necklace above all else. But finally, she gives it up, and he says, because I've got this real pearl necklace for you because I love you so much. But we hang on to the thing that's worth less because we don't know that God's promised us more. And we're afraid to take that step. We hang on to our wicked life or our drunken life or our crazy life. We hang on to all this stuff because the whole world says, oh, dude, don't go with those Christians. They're crazy. And then as you hang around with Christians, you find out these guys are cool. And you know what? There's power in that house. Something's happening in there. And look, I'm not trying to bust on anybody. I mean, I know there's a lot of folks out here that aren't married. So look, I'm not throwing anything on you. This is between you and God. That's your stuff. You're going to work that out. I'm not trying to guilt you. But we know where some of this stuff goes. I was a person who gave myself over to people who wanted to abuse me repeatedly. I would pick people that were desperately bad for me because I was desperate to be loved, and I would give them all my best stuff only to be crushed and tossed aside and heartbroken. So it's not just chicks that do this. Although chicks, you know, some of you gals, you've experienced this stuff. Why can't anyone just love me for who I am? I've seen folks enslaved by bad relationships and poor choices, and often folks don't even see it. I've seen situations where people have drawn near to the Lord Jesus Christ. They've touched his very robe. Maybe they've been healed. Maybe they've cast demons out of their house. Maybe there's suddenly been peace in their home for the very first time ever. But then they got a promotion at work, or they got a promotion at the club, or they got a promotion to the... And suddenly they slip away and they're not walking in the river. And things turn bad. It seemed like it was a good thing to get the promotion, but it really just pulled you just out of the flow of the river of God's love. Amen? In airborne operations, the likelihood of two parachutes colliding, because you see the parachutes jump out of each side of the airplane, and if there's a wind, they can tangle. Now, Kenny McDonald talked about a time that he was tangled. He was in the 82nd Airborne. He's tangled with a guy. The other guy's panicking. Kenny has to climb down the ropes, get the guy under control by punching him, and then untangle things, get that guy's reserve chute deployed, get himself away, and deploy his chute, all the while dropping to very hard ground. It takes a level of willingness to stay alive, to battle for life in that situation. And so jump masters review these collision problems and solutions with men. You practice them all the time. That's part of why Kenny was able to do this. And when there's a collision, they become entangled, meaning they need to work themselves free, which Kenny did. He can tell you that story, that he worked himself free. They both lived. They both made the jump. They lived to the ground. Everything was good. I'm sure there was messy pants, but... But when all that effort fails, they call this term hopelessly entangled. And whether he admits it or not, the jumper is in a dangerous and deadly situation. When you're hopelessly entangled, you need to take your knife and cut the cords. and get far enough away from that debris before you deploy your reserve. And pray that reserve opens in time, because it doesn't have the same chute size as the one you just cut loose. So we're already going to hit the ground hard with that one. Now we're going to hit it even harder with this one, but not hard enough to die. Without a savior, without our rescuer, without Jesus, we are hopelessly entangled in sin. We just are. There's no way out. It says in Hebrews 12, therefore, since we're surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We are spiritual POWs, and our captor, Satan, will not give us up without a fight. Like the prisoners in the Filipino city, we have no hope of escape. We've been ensnared in our own free choices. If we die without rescue, only one fate remains. If we die without the rescuer, Jesus, then we go to hell. And fortunately, from the beginning of time, God saw our desperate need and set in motion a daring rescue. The great raid was underway. Let's look at how the mission originated. See, every good raid starts with planning. So if you're going to raid someplace, you've got to have a plan. You know what? And you will have practiced and rehearsed. Why were those men so deadly? 121 men against 800 with 10,000 on the other shore. Why were they so swift and deadly? Because they had practiced and practiced and practiced this scenario so often that they truly could do this in their sleep. So, God's been planning. And in the early days of the operation, God gave only subtle hints. If you read from Genesis forward, you'll see some little hints. And he hints about his rescue plan. So God put the serpent on notice, that's Satan, for what he had done to Adam and Eve. And this is what he says in Genesis 3. I will cause hostility between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel. Centuries later, God chose Abraham's family to be his chosen vehicle for infiltration into the enemy territory. And God told him, I will make you a great nation. All families on earth will be blessed through you. It says in Genesis 12. God was promising a divine rescuer through Abraham's bloodline. Later, the scepter will not part from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from his descendants, until the coming of the rescuer to whom it belongs, the one whom nations will honor. Genesis 49. And he told King David, I will raise up one of your descendants, and I will secure his royal throne forever. In 2 Samuel 7. This would be the forever king, the great rescuer who would accomplish the raid God had in mind. And the raid would not be without casualties. The rescuer himself would be captured and tortured and murdered. In our Bible in a year, we've been reading on, we posted on Facebook, but in our Bible in the year, we've been reading Isaiah 51 to 54, and all in there is the prophecy of how the Messiah would be born, what would happen, how he would die, describes crucifixion to the letter in a time where crucifixion hadn't even been invented. And it also prophesied the resurrection, because he rolled the stone away. Our divine rescuer would be exceptional. He'd be miraculously conceived from a specific lineage, but also had the courage required to trade his life for our life, his life for this world. And he did it in a most gruesome way. If you watched The Passion of the Christ is the clearest description of a crucifixion possible. And if you don't cry in that to realize how amazingly loved you must be for the God of creation to endure such scourging and such awful treatment, to say, forgive them, they know not what they do.
Jesus above all.
Effective combat leaders spend a great deal of time planning a great raid, and obviously God did too. When the time was right, God sent his son to rescue you and me. And in doing this, he displayed two of the necessary elements of a great raid: tactical patience and surprise. For tactical patience, God waited for the right conditions to deploy his rescuer. This is what it says in Galatians. When the time was right, God sent his son to buy freedom for us who were slaves. Historians point to three circumstances that aided in humanity's rescue in that specific time when Jesus came. When Jesus came, there was a unified language. Alexander the Great had conquered the civilized world, and there was one language, a simple Greek language, that now we have a lot of our Bible was translated into Greek in the early days. So everyone could speak Greek. It's kind of like everyone can speak English. There was a transportation network. The Romans had built the most complicated and amazing highway system and shipping system ever to exist. Some Roman roads are still used today. And there was a unified government. You may not have liked the government, but there was one government, and that was Rome. Everything was unified. But the second thing was surprise, and rangers were taught to do the unexpected. They don't travel the easy road. You don't see rangers walking down a street ever. They sleep in difficult and impossible terrain. The author talks about a time that he and his guys were on a patrol in Iraq, and they were on a mission, and they found a jagged cliffside to sleep on because no patrol was going to look for them there. They sleep in impossible terrain. They walk through swamps and mountainsides. And no patrol is going to look for them there because nobody wants to go there. If you're the guy on patrol, someone says, you want to check the swamp out? No. No, I don't. Let them stay in the swamp. God chose Mary, a peasant girl. No one expected God to work through the controversy of pregnancy out of wedlock. Nobody expected this. He didn't choose the well-connected people of the world. He picked common people. They were really nearly invisible, even stealth, unnoticeable. Rather than the predictable path, he intentionally did the unexpected and used the unlikely to accomplish his divine purpose, and he still does today. Is there anyone unlikely in the house? If you've seen my resume, we don't live in my hometown. I grew up, well, no one's really sure where I grew up yet because I haven't grown up, but I grew up in Foxborough. And Debbie and I have been to Foxborough and just randomly run into people who remember the day. You remember the day you were on the hill and you did this? And Debbie's like, I don't even know that dude. In Soul Care this week, we're talking about our life stuff. I was just a rotten, mean, rotten, selfish, rotten, mean, rotten, selfish, mean person. And I found great humor in causing other people pain. I enjoyed doing bad things to nice people because I was angry. And I started to describe this, and I thought, I don't really even know this dude anymore because of what Christ done in my life. Amen. You guys may have... He uses the unlikely. He takes that messy resume of failure and meanness and rottenness and says, I have a plan for you, son. You're coming with me. And I was dragging my feet. I don't think so. And then I was like, you know, Jesus is awesome. When I started reading the Bible, I was telling people, somebody should have told me this. This is awesome. Jesus loves me. Woo! You guys got to hear this. Jesus loves me. And it's awesome. You got an ex-wife. You're a piece of crap. I hate you guys. You smell like a dirty diaper. Yeah, but Jesus loves me. It's awesome when you realize the God of creation loves you even in your ugly messiness. You can't even clean it up. He says, come on, get your stinky butt in here. I love you. God, the ultimate tactician, surprised everybody by the way he chose to infiltrate his rescuer into planet Earth. He took thousands of years from the time that Adam and Eve were there until his invasion on Earth to ensure that everything went exactly right. The mission's been unparalleled. Just allow yourself for a moment in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Just allow yourself to become overwhelmed. Think of yourself as that POW who's about to be marched into the bunker and lit on fire. Think of yourself as that person when God himself comes out and loves you enough to say, I've got you. I've got a plan for you. Think of how... Go to that overwhelming, loving place right now. Amen. He loves you. Yes. He loves you so much that he wanted to make a way just for you. And let this intense feeling nudge you to reject that comfortable or even numbed Western life and enlist in God's global mission that he's calling you to. He's calling you. Yes. You, the courageous few. He's calling you, the loved and courageous and redeemed. He's calling you and saying, come. I'll clean you up. Ask for forgiveness of those sins and then come on. Yes. Let's go save the rest of the prisoners. Yes. Come on. Rather than perpetuate cold, lifeless religion, a lot of us grew up in churches and are like, I don't get the point of this place. I just don't even get the point. I remember I was still drinking, but I was in my church as a youth, as a kid. I'm like, I don't get why you guys are so bummed out because we should be, if Jesus is who he says he is, there should be some excitement in the house. If we really believe that he did what he did, I should be jumping. I should be more excited than a Patriots touchdown. I should be saying, Jesus is awesome. Rather than perpetuate that cold, lifeless religion, let your faith be infused with the energy of a heart set free and filled to overflowing with that river of the Holy Spirit from God himself. The very power of God coming into you. Your hairs rise up on your arms and you feel the presence of God and you want to cry and you want to laugh all at once. You want to be able to say, he loves me. Yes. He loves me. Yes. And until we can appreciate God's rescue plan and experience the joy of being personally rescued, we'll never be willing to join him in the fight for all the other POWs. Amen. So when you think about how much others would appreciate being saved. You know, we often, well, I don't want to upset my friend. You know what? If you just talk to people in love and don't be one of those obnoxious, jam it down your throat, Jesus dudes, just, could you just love somebody? Can you just be their friend? So with the friend last night, and he said, I've never felt the love that I felt in this place. I don't really know Jesus. I'm not even sure if I want Team Jesus, but I sure want whatever you guys got. And I said, well, hey, man, it's Jesus. And he's weeping. I don't think he can forgive me. And I said, yeah, man, he can. Yeah, he can. Yeah, he can. So when you think about how much you appreciate what God, what Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, has done for us, that he's jumped in. My chains have been broken. I've become the man God had in mind. I become a man who loves his wife and honors her and raised a family together. I become a man who knows how to love others. I become a man of integrity. And I very rarely jump out of my truck and want to punch people. So the plan is complete. We've all received our orders, and the conditions are set. The question now, are you ready to join the rescuer on this great raid and take back what the enemy has stolen? Because if tonight's the night for you to just do some Jesus business and enlist, you know, my friend calls it Team Jesus. And it's kind of a good way to put it. You know, when I joined the Army, I signed my whole life over to the United States of America to do whatever they desire. In fact, my body became their property. I couldn't get tattoos. I couldn't, there was a lot. I signed my life and my allegiance over to the United States of America, but only for a time. And if I could survive it, they did call up Vietnam just for me, so that worked out. But if I could survive it, I'd be someplace. But when you turn to Jesus Christ and you say, oh, rescuer of my soul, oh, Jesus, my Savior, forgive me for all the ways that I've dishonored you and even myself. Let me forgive myself as I'm covered with your blood of forgiveness, your blood sacrifice. Let me turn from my ways and the ways that Satan told me were good, and they've only left me broken and brokenhearted. I want the river. Yes. I want the river, Jesus. I want the river, and I want the fullness, and I want to know who I am in your eyes, and I want to feel your presence. I don't want to feel you hold me. I don't want to feel real love. And I want to be forgiven. And I can't possibly earn it. Please forgive me. Please make me yours. Because I know I've been created for something better than what I've been living. Yes. If you've prayed that prayer quietly or online, then Jesus has become your Lord and your Savior. If you've prayed that prayer, then it's time to get to know him, because all he wants is an intimate relationship with us. And he says, I have moved heaven and earth for you. And not only that, I've made you my brother or my sister. You are now heirs to the kingdom, and I want to give you all the stuff that the king's heirs walk in. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to his name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I want to thank you all for being here tonight. I know that I've been doing an awful job picking up the offering. I just get in the zone with Jesus, and, you know, if it's on your heart to give to the church, there's folks that are here to accept that. If it's on your heart to give, great. If it's not, don't you worry. God gives this church more than we could possibly imagine. We are blessed beyond what we could ever think. And he is doing stuff in this place that I only dreamed of. In fact, most of the stuff I hadn't dreamt. And his dreams are way bigger. for me and for you. So be blessed in Jesus' name tonight, and know how important you are to the great rescuer. Amen.
You gotta help me make a stand. You just gotta see me through another day. My body's aching and my time is at hand, and I won't make it any other way. I seen fire and I seen rain. I've seen sunny days that I thought would never end. I've seen lonely times when I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. Oh, won't you look down upon me, Jesus? You gotta help me make a stand. Gotta see me through another day. My body is aching, time is at hand, and I won't make it any other way. I see fire and I see rain, sunny days that I thought would never end. Seen lonely times when I could not find a friend, but I always saw that I see you. I seen fire, I seen rain, sunny days that I thought would never end, lonely times when I could not find a friend.
Class dismissed.
Thank you. power and truth will break in. It's time for the hearts to awaken.
Chastisement of our people.